Welcome to worship this morning at First Baptist Church in Middlesboro, Kentucky. It's good to look out there and see you, and it was nice to hear all the fellowship going on, and we feel so close together. Thank you. That's very nice. We're glad you're here today if you're part of our family, and if you're a guest today, you're welcome here. We're glad you're here. There's an edge of the bulletin you can tear off and put some information on it about yourself, put it in the offering plate so we can know a little bit more about you. We have two opportunities very important this week. One is a fellowship opportunity. On next Sunday morning at 10 a.m., we're having First Fellowship again. And it's bring something potluck for breakfast, maybe a fruit bowl or a casserole or some rolls. Bring those with you next Sunday morning, 10 o'clock. We have fellowship together in Fellowship Hall, the whole church, and then we have a devotional time. So I hope you'll be there. You are invited. You can bring someone with you also. You have a ministry opportunity this week. This is our last week that we're trying to bring things for CCM. We need to bring canned goods and hygiene items, and you've been seeing this the last few weeks. We need to make sure we get it all filled up this week. So this week, if you'll bring it, we'll get it down there to them. And also, if you'll notice in your bulletin, the new office hours are there. If you're wondering when you can visit the office, it's listed in your bulletin. Will you take this time now to greet each other and the people around you?
Thank you.
is your name in all the earth. We are here this morning to give praise, to give you praise. We praise you for who you are. We thank you that you created us and that you love us, even as frail and as broken as we are. Be with us this morning in this sanctuary. Hear our prayers and our hymns as gifts to you. Speak to us through your creation, through the words and the music we hear, and in that still, small voice. In our Savior's name we pray. Amen. If you'll take your worship bulletin, we'll read our Lent responsive reading. God of love, God of peace, this fractured world cries out in pain, burns deep into my soul. God of love, God of peace.
God is your world.
Scarred by griefs and tears, ignorance and fear.
Soften hearts of stone and begin with mine.
God of love, God of peace.
Create within me a heart for people.
A desire for change.
For new beginnings.
A fresh attitude to start each day with you at its center. Let's sing together hymn number 7. Actually, it's in your bulletin. Insert in your bulletin. You are my hiding place.
Same spirit of the words we just sang from Psalm 32, we read as our Old Testament reading today, Psalm 27. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the stronghold of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? When evildoers assail me to devour my flesh, my adversaries and foes, they shall stumble and fall. Though an army encamp against me, my heart shall not fear. Though war rise up against me, yet I will be confident. One thing I ask of the Lord, that will I seek after: to live in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to behold the beauty of the Lord and to inquire in his temple. For he will hide me in his shelter in the day of trouble. He will conceal me under the cover of his tent. He will set me high on a rock. Now my head is lifted up above my enemies all around me, and I will offer in his tent sacrifices with shouts of joy. I will sing and make melody to the Lord. Hear, O Lord, when I cry aloud. Be gracious to me and answer me. Come, my heart says, seek his face. Your face, Lord, I do seek. Do not hide your face from me. Do not turn your servant away in anger, you who have been my help. Do not cast me off. Do not forsake me, O God of my salvation. If my father and mother forsake me, the Lord will take me up. Teach me your way, O Lord, and lead me on a level path because of my enemies. Do not give me up to the will of my adversaries, for false witnesses have risen against me, and they are breathing out violence. I believe that I shall see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Wait for the Lord. Be strong, and let your heart take courage. Wait for the Lord. May God bless the reading of these words to our hearing and to our believing. May we pray together. Dear God, we gather as your people in this place dedicated to you. We gather to worship. We gather for fellowship. We gather to encourage one another. We find courage in the words of the Psalms as they remind us of our security in you. We find comfort in the presence of one another as we share each other's burdens and so fulfill the law of Christ, which is love. We pray for those of our number today who are sick and pray your healing upon them. We pray for those who have been touched by grief and loss and ask that you would be their comforter. We pray for ourselves as we seek to be your people and to follow you faithfully, consistent with your will and work in the world. We thank you, dear God, that you sent your Son Jesus to seek and to save the lost. And we confess that we've strayed from you and turn aside from the way that you would have us to go. We're sometimes misled by pride. We sometimes try to fool ourselves to see ourselves as pure when we really are stained. Sometimes we think of ourselves as great when we are small. We have failed to love, we have failed to show justice, and we at times have ignored your truth. So we confess our shortcomings and pray your forgiveness and a fresh new start with you. We thank you that through the gift of your Son, you have saved us from sin and evil and shown us how to live in your world. May our lives reflect the fullness of the good news of Jesus Christ, so that we can be a part of bringing justice and peace and love to your world. So in this time of worship, we dedicate ourselves again, our gifts, our commitments, to you as a God of grace, to allow us to be a part of your work, your healing, your compassion, your justice. Use us in Christ's service. As we walk the way of Christ, led by his Spirit, and praying the words that he taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
If all the children would join me for the children's service. Good morning. I bet that you all have something kind of like this at home, don't you? This is my favorite blanket. This is my favorite blanket. When I was a little girl, I had a favorite blanket, too. And sometimes when I'd get scared, like if it was dark and it was late and everybody was already in bed and I heard a sound, I was like, oh, my goodness, what was that? Or, and I still get afraid of this, but if the wind was blowing a lot and there was thunder and lightning, sometimes the best thing to do was hide under my blanket. Because it made me feel better. And you know what? That kind of reminds me of something that Dr. Garner just read, which was the psalm for today. And let me read just a part of it for you. This is Psalms 27, verse 5. And it says, when I'm in trouble, he will keep me safe in his house. He will hide me in the safety of his holy tent. He will put me on a rock that is very high. And you know what that says? That says that Jesus and God are better than my blanket. They're like the very best blanket ever. Because sometimes the blanket had to go in the wash, or sometimes I forgot it at home. But you know what the good thing about God is? He is like the very best blanket because he's always there. When we're scared or we're in trouble, he takes us and he covers us up and he keeps us safe and he protects us. And so God is the very best blanket ever. And maybe next time you're scared or something's a little bit wrong, maybe we'll remember that God is the very best blanket and we're safe with him. Let's pray. Lord, thank you for being the very blessed blanket ever and for protecting us and keeping us safe. Amen.
God is faithful. Let's sing our hymn of offertory, number 48, Great is Thy Faithfulness. Will you stand with me as we sing?
Oh,
thank you for your faithfulness to us. You are our strength and our provider. We want to take the blessings we've received and share them with others. Accept our gifts today. Amen.
Sing, sing, sing unto the Lord, let us bless his holy name.
Thank you, musicians. The season of Lent offers us opportunity after opportunity to identify with Jesus. How does the life of Jesus offer us an example and a challenge for our own lives of spiritual commitment to God? In last week's gospel reading, which we are taking during Lent from the Gospel of Luke, in last week's reading, Luke told us about the temptations of Jesus in the wilderness. And today we read about another challenge that Jesus faced. Our reading from Luke's Gospel is found in chapter 13, beginning at verse 31 and reading through verse 35. At that very hour, some Pharisees came and said to him, "Get away from here, for Herod wants to kill you." He said to them, "Go and tell that fox for me. Listen, I am casting out demons and performing cures today and tomorrow, and on the third day I finish my work. Yet today, tomorrow, and the next day I must be on my way, because it is impossible for a prophet to be killed outside of Jerusalem. Jerusalem, Jerusalem, the city that kills the prophets and stones those who are sent to it. How often have I desired to gather your children together as a hen gathers her brood under her wings, but you were not willing. See, your house is left to you, and I tell you, you will not see me until the time comes when you say, 'Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord.'" This is a puzzling passage from Luke. In some ways, it's puzzling. Some scholars have even suggested that Luke took several different sayings of Jesus and put them together here, something like a quilt. But what's going on here when Jesus calls King Herod a fox and refers to himself as a mother hen? Well, the occasion seems to be that some of Jesus' opponents, at least they were usually his opponents, the Pharisees, maybe they had more in common than we sometimes think. But here are some Pharisees who are warning Jesus. Apparently, Herod has heard enough about Jesus' doings and wants to kill him. And it's puzzling to see the Pharisees warning Jesus. Dave Eward has suggested maybe their attitude, the attitude of the Pharisees, was, "Anyone who is an enemy of my enemy is a friend." And since the Pharisees didn't like Herod either, maybe in a world in which it was always, "Now whose side are you on?" the Pharisees regarded Jesus as on their side, at least as far as Herod went. So they warned him. But if you think about it, though they may not have intended to tempt Jesus, the warning of the Pharisees is a whole lot like those three tests with which we saw Jesus tempted last week. Oh, it's not the test of glory or authority or security. Now, Jesus here must pass the test of fear. But when the Pharisees warn him to run, they're still encouraging him, just like the devil did, to abandon his mission, save himself. Herod was the son of Herod the Great. The Herod in this passage is Herod Antipas, who was one of the sons succeeding the really bad guy, Herod the Great, dividing up the kingdom. And Herod Antipas was the tetrarch of Galilee. Luke gives this Herod lots of attention. He's already been mentioned as the one who arrested John the Baptizer after John confronted him about his marriage and his other atrocities. Luke's already told us that Herod has heard about Jesus, and at first Herod thought John the Baptist had come back from the dead, but come to find out it's two guys, John and now Jesus. And at the end of Luke's gospel, when Jesus is on trial, Pilate sent Jesus over to Herod, who had been wanting to meet him and see him do a miracle, but when Jesus just stood there and did nothing, Herod and his henchmen humiliate Jesus, send him back to Pilate, which sort of patched up a relationship that Pilate and Herod had. Luke's very clear. This Herod guy is interwoven into the narrative of Jesus' ministry in the gospel according to Luke. But in this text, warned by the Pharisees that Herod is going to try to kill him, Jesus says, "You go back and you tell him I said." The Greek here in the New Testament paragraph of Luke 13 doesn't really say that Jesus said, "Go right now, I'm telling you, I'm commanding you, go and deliver my message." It's much less direct than that. It's not a command. Let me paraphrase what I think Jesus is communicating. Next time you see Herod, that old fox, you tell him that I'm going about my business of establishing the kingdom of God. You can let him know that I'm doing what I came to do. Things like casting out demons and accomplishing healings. And you can tell him that I'll be doing those kinds of things and more of the works of God today and tomorrow and the day after that, right up until I die. And a little threat from Herod is not nearly enough to stop me. It would probably help to do just a little review of geography to appreciate Jesus' words and the occasion of challenge that Jesus was facing. Jerusalem was down in Judah, the southern region of the country. But Herod was the tetrarch up in Galilee, the northern region, where Jesus and John the Baptizer, their families, were from. That's why Herod had early contact with them. And the northern region of Galilee was the same region, you recall, where Jesus began his ministry. We saw that in Luke chapter 4 a few weeks ago, Jesus' inaugural sermon at his hometown synagogue in Nazareth in the north. And Jesus said he was going to be leaving the north and heading south on his expanded ministry out of Galilee into Judea all the way to Jerusalem. In fact, Luke has already told us, we're in chapter 13. Back in chapter 9, Luke made it very clear at a turning point, a cusp, a fulcrum, a hinge of Jesus' ministry when he left Galilee and headed southward. Now Jesus set his face to go to Jerusalem. That was Luke 9:51, and we're in chapter 13. So Jesus brings up Jerusalem, not as a place he's going to run and hide in the big city to get out of Herod's north. No, he's going to leave Galilee. He's going to go elsewhere. But not because the Pharisees warned him that things were getting hot up north. He's going to leave because that's where his ministry takes him, all the way to Jerusalem, where every Hebrew prophet goes to die. There's a deeply sad irony in these words that Jesus speaks about Jerusalem. Jerusalem. That was the place where Solomon had built the temple. The temple that the psalmist talks about, being in the temple and in the protection of God's presence. The temple, the very house of God, where God dwelled in the midst of God's people, there in the Holy of Holies. Jerusalem, the holy city, the place of pilgrimages and worship, where sacrifices were given and prayers were offered and psalms were sung. I was glad when they said unto me, "Let us go up to the house of the Lord." So why does Jesus say these strange and hard words about Jerusalem? As the place where prophets were killed, Jesus says in so many words, no real prophet dies anywhere else but in Jerusalem. Jesus is clearly aware of what is likely to come as a response to his work. His frustrations in his ministry are going to end in a fatality, his own. He is not naive about what will happen at the end of his ministry. The authorities in power are not going to be able to control him. He is fearless in his dedication to God's will. The Romans are not going to like his kingdom talk. They hear him as a revolutionary leading an insurrection. And the Jewish leaders are not going to like his approach to Scripture because he's not following their traditional interpretations. So the Romans are going to treat him like a radical, and the Jews were convinced that he was a heretical liberal. These people in power will want to cleanse their little world of all of his wrong. But Jesus was steadfast, clear-eyed, settled in his heart. He was about doing the will of God in the world, no matter what. Neither frustration nor fear was going to stop him. I've used the words of Alice McKenzie before to illustrate biblical text. She's really good on this one too. How could the journey of a prophet to Jerusalem ever end well? Well, maybe if the prophet realized the danger, was overcome by the prospect of discomfort, and turned back. But Jesus is a determined sort. I must be on my way, Jesus says. There is a sense of determination and inevitability in Jesus' view of his journey toward Jerusalem. Alice McKenzie continues, I admire people who have this kind of determination. I sometimes think that if I had known what I was getting into, I wouldn't have gotten into it. You can apply that to whatever situations in your life, and I can apply them to mine. At the first sign of discomfort, I think, why did I make this commitment? It seemed like a good idea at the time, but now I can't remember why. This is harder than I thought it would be. I didn't sign on for this. No one told me about this. Nobody likes discomfort along the journey of life. That's why we coin little phrases to help us along the way, like, I can stand anything as long as I can whine about it. Or, what doesn't kill you makes you stronger. But neither of those phrases and a dozen more like them fits our Savior's situation here in Luke 13. Jesus has signed on willingly for a journey whose path he knows will be littered with resistance, rejection, and likely death. He is not whining. He is lamenting. The context is an intense conflict of wills, the intention of Jesus' adversaries, the determination of the Messiah, the unwillingness of Jerusalem, and the determination of God to fulfill his divine will. Who signs on for this kind of drama? Jerusalem is a site of great evil, but also of great things. Jerusalem is where human sinfulness and divine intervention meet. Our sinfulness meets a crucified prophet. Jerusalem is the end, but it's also the beginning of something else, the church. You're going to Jerusalem, just expect to die. We can be in awe of Jesus' faith and determination as he laments over Jerusalem, and yet in the context of loving determination, he presses on to go there. He presses on, believing in this intense clash of wills, that God's will prevails. He presses on, believing that in the city of death, life awaits him, that in the midst of pain, there is the glory of God. In Luke's gospel, it's still early. There's still time to back out. But instead, our Savior says, I must be on my way. In this season of Lent, let us set our feet on his path, Alice McKenzie concludes. Let us walk with him through resistance and discomfort. We will find that with him as our companion, the path leads to the joy of service and to a love that is stronger than death. It seems to me that there are two voices in this week's text. Run for your life, Jesus. Run. The king is out to kill you. Get out of here. Find a place to protect yourself. Jerusalem, Jerusalem. If I had my way, I would protect you like a mother hen shelters her brood of chicks. But you refuse me, and you will kill me. Nancy Rockwell has written of this passage a little commentary called That Fox. In scripture and in art, Jesus is shown doing many things: praying, walking, knocking on doors, gathering crowds, climbing hills, calling disciples, writing in the sand with his finger, sharing bread, preaching, weeping, but never running. This is neither the first nor the last time someone will tempt Jesus into fear. It's even a temptation urged upon him by people who loved him and wanted to protect him. But it's a temptation to which Jesus never gives in. That doesn't mean Jesus was impervious to fear. He felt it. But he stays his course in commitment to what he has to do. He does not let Herod distract him. He does not let Herod co-opt him in fear, in flight, or in fury. Herod was worth running from. His reputation as the foremost biblical bully has lasted now for 2,000 years. Herod was not so much a despot as he was a manipulator, which is a bully's prime talent. His trade was quelling resistance and achieving a working order. His weapons were money, work, and opulence. His works were huge, elaborate, and costly. Jesus' works are human, disarmingly simple, freely given, and liberating. Knowing all of this about himself, Jesus says that he is the hen and Herod is the fox. He wished he could gather Jerusalem as a hen gathers her brood under her wings. Think about the hen, the homely hen who's lived in the backyards of human beings for thousands of years. She is selfless in her devotion to her little ones, who are even more defenseless than she. She has no defenses against the arts and the wiles of foxes, except her courage and her commitment. She will rush to the sharp teeth and long claws, the looming shadow, the fierce bloodlust of foxes, throwing herself upon the bodies of her chicks, extending her wings over them, letting herself be devoured in the hope that they might be spared. The hen does not run from her fears. And a part of the way that Jesus spreads his wings over us is that we too can find in our work in the kingdom the courage to face ugly dangers, to let life bite deeply into us as we are busy sheltering those in our care. One of the most powerful illustrations of courage under hardship is the story of Clarence Jordan and his ministry at Koinonia Farms near Americus, Georgia. You've heard me tell this story before, but I'm going to go over it again. Like Jesus, Clarence was doing the work of the kingdom of God. Clarence was doing his own version of casting out the demons of poverty and prejudice, and completing the healings of broken and hurting people of color. He was a man of unusual abilities. I'm quoting now from Tim Hansel. Clarence Jordan was a man of unusual abilities and commitment. He had two PhDs, one in agriculture and one in Greek and Hebrew. So gifted was he could have chosen to do anything he wanted. He chose to serve the poor. In the 1940s, he founded a farm in Americus, Georgia, and called it Koinonia Farm. It was a community for poor whites and poor blacks. As you might guess, such an idea did not go over well in the deep south of the 40s. Ironically, much of the resistance came from good church people who followed the laws of segregation as much as the other folks in town. The town people tried everything to stop Clarence. They tried boycotting him and slashing workers' tires when they came to town. Over and over for 14 years, they tried to stop him. Finally, in 1954, the Ku Klux Klan had had enough of Clarence Jordan, so they decided to get rid of him once and for all. They came one night with guns and torches and set fire to every building on Koinonia Farm, except Clarence's house, which they riddled with bullets. And they chased off all the families except one black family who refused to leave. Clarence recognized the voices of many of the Klansmen under their hoods, and as you might guess, some of them were church people. One of them was the local newspaper's reporter. So the next day, the reporter came out in his street dress to see what remained of the farm and to report it in the paper. The rubble still smoldered and the land was scorched, but he found Clarence in the field, hoeing and planting. "I heard the awful news," he said to Clarence, "and I came out to do a story on the tragedy of your farm closing." Clarence just kept hoeing and planting. The reporter kept prodding, kept poking, trying to get a rise from this quietly determined man who seemed to be planting instead of packing his bags. So finally the reporter said in a haughty voice, "Well, Dr. Jordan, you get two of them PhDs and you've got 14 years into this farm and there's nothing left of it at all. Just how successful do you think you've been?" Clarence stopped hoeing, turned toward the reporter with his penetrating blue eyes, and said quietly but firmly, "I've been about as successful as the cross. Sir, I don't think you understand us. What we're about is not success, but faithfulness. We're staying. Good day." Beginning that day, Clarence and his companions rebuilt Koinonia, and the farm is still going strong today. You go tell that old fox. He doesn't frustrate me at all. I'm too busy today, tomorrow, and the next day, casting out demons and accomplishing healings. We're talking about the kingdom of God here. And even the worst deeds in Jerusalem are not going to stop it. The thing about Lent is we get a chance to follow Jesus through the challenges of his ministry and to make that same commitment. Jesus says in Luke's gospel, "If anyone would come after me, let him take up his cross daily, daily, and follow me." As followers of the Lord Jesus, we get to die a little bit every day. It takes courage and commitment. And so we sing the song of reassurance and commitment, hymn number 629, "Be strong in the Lord and be of good courage." I invite you to stand and sing these words together as your own affirmation of faith and commitment to Christ, inspired by his example, empowered by his Spirit. We sing these words of service. May we stand together and sing 629.